darkness, His love is mighty, and so much stronger.
Somebody 90 seconds to come and share. Yesterday we had, I don't know, anybody else, how many of you led somebody to Christ yesterday, soul winning? We have one that I know of. Aaron, I'm going to give you 90 seconds to come and testify to that. You get what you honor, and so when somebody's led to Christ, somebody makes a decision of faith, that's worth honoring. So come right on, Brother Aaron, and share that, and after that we'll have prayer.
So me and Brandon were out on our soul winning visitation yesterday with Charity Church. As we went out, we were having pretty good visits. It was a really blessed day for us. Before we got to the house where we led someone to the Lord, we actually were at a house with a woman who had, as soon as we walked in her driveway, she had just gotten home, and it turns out she was looking for a church. She has a family of six. And as we were telling her about the church, telling her about how the church is having a harvest festival, she just seemed so receptive. She was so excited. She was talking about it all the way to her door. And then we got to the last house on that street, and it looked like somebody was home, so we went up there, we knocked, and immediately a young guy came to the door. And, you know, looking at him and realizing that this is his home, you would expect him to be 23, 24. It turns out he's just 15. He doesn't have a really good relationship with his father. Him and his father don't get along well, and he doesn't really know him that well. And he doesn't live with his mother either, actually. He lives by himself at the age of 15. Which is a very interesting thing, and he is extremely mature for his age. As we began talking, I asked him, well, do you go to church anywhere? And he said, well, no, I don't right now. I'd like to. And he explained to me how he loves gospel music, how he loves just singing and all. He was telling me about all these old gospel groups and everything like that, so we were connecting with that. And then I ended up asking him, you know, after we gave him information about the church, and we were talking about the church, I asked him, you know, if you were to die right now, are you 100% sure you would go to heaven? And he looked at me, and he thought for a second, well, I'd say I'm about 65% sure. I give back to the community. I help that lady down the street because those kids don't have a father figure in their life. And I go, can I be honest with you? It's not about your works. It's all about what Jesus Christ has done for you and your faith in him. And so I was able to lead him down the salvation through the Romans road and just begin to speak to him about that. And, you know, I asked him at the end of that, do you want to make the decision to accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior? And he said, yes. And, you know, I was able to lead him to the Lord, and it was just an amazing experience. And it was wonderful to know that a young 15-year-old man who has a different family situation, a difficult life in that regards, was able to come to know Jesus Christ as his Lord and Savior. And I'm just thankful to be able to do that. I'm thankful that the Lord used me and Bree in that capacity. So let's praise the Lord for that. Brother Steve. Amen.
So God be all glory, honor, and praise. And we all need from time to time to be encouraged that our labor for the Lord is not in vain. And you knock on a lot of doors, you talk to a lot of people before you have the privilege and honor to lead someone to Christ. But the truth is, our going and our telling about the great name of Jesus is obedience. It is our part. And so be faithful in doing that. And his first name begins with K, Kendall. So let's pray for him now. And as we do that, Father, in Jesus' name, we come to you and we thank you, Lord, for the opportunity to serve in our local churches. We thank you, Lord, for yesterday. The probably over 100 gospel presentations were handed out by our students. Lord, some will not be read at all. We ask, Holy Spirit, that you would move on hearts and keep that track somewhere, Lord, to where when somebody's hurting, they may reach down and find it, maybe on the counter somewhere. Then, Lord, for those that maybe took a moment to peruse the track, maybe read some of it, Holy Spirit, I pray that you'd move on their hearts, draw them closer to you. May it be something that just deals with them, and they begin to deal with the truth as they look around and they see what's going on in our world and the fight for truth, and those that would just deny truth. It has to be frustrating for people that know right and wrong down in their hearts. I pray, Lord, that they would see that you are the way, that you are the truth, and you are the light. I pray that more folks would come to Christ, Lord, from our efforts yesterday, whether or not we ever find out about it on this side of eternity. Lord, may souls be saved from our efforts. We thank you for the privilege to be in this chapel service today. We pray, Lord, that you'd give us what we need. No doubt, Lord, with all of us in here, we've got different burdens, different hurts, different needs. Lord, different areas we need to grow in that we're not even aware of ourselves, but you know on our path to maturity what we need. So I pray, Lord, through song and through your preached word, that you would draw us closer to you today. Maybe be more than what we were when we came in. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Would you stand under the white covers?
I don't know about you guys, but that story, it excites me. The fact that someone has given their life to Christ, this is exciting to me. We're going to sing a song right now, Amazing Grace. It's a familiar song. But I'm just so thankful for the grace of God in my life. And the chorus of the song is a new chorus. It says, my chains are gone. I've been set free. My God, my Savior, has ransomed me. He's paid a debt that he did not owe because it's a debt that we couldn't pay. And he did it for us. He did it for each and every one of us because he loves us so much. So as we sing this song, just think about that grace of God in your life. Think about how it's completely transformed you from the person that you used to be. And just let the song speak to your heart as we sing Amazing Grace. Share the story of the grace that you gave to each and every one of us with those around us, Lord, in our community, Lord, the people that we work with, the people that we see on a regular basis, Lord, or those that we're just passing by at Walmart or wherever we are, Lord. I just pray that you would use us, Lord. Use us to show your grace to those who are in desperate need of it. Lord, we thank you so much for everything you do in our lives. We love you and thank you. Be with us in this chapel service today. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Please be seated. Before Devin, Bradley, and Britt come to sing a trio, it's our pleasure to introduce to you Pastor Ken Katz from Trinity. We're proud to have him today. He's brought Bruce along with him. I'm not sure who was chauffeuring, but they came together, and we're proud to have them. Brother Ken, and they let us know that they were caught up in traffic and things today, and so we were expecting them. For you preachers out there, be sure when you're going to speak somewhere, let folks know how you're doing, because it lets everybody rest easy. But I assure you that we knew they were going to make it, and they kept us informed. But Brother Ken has had a wonderful ministry, touched so many lives. He served at the Bethel Church, a youth minister for many, many years, and preached many, many, many camps, touched a lot of people, and now pastoring the church there in Greenville as well. They've got a large Christian school, and his children came through Southeastern. They ministered and served and went out on the road for us, and we're grateful for them and their ministry, his continued ministry. He continues to hire our alumni, and we're proud of all them. And I was by there on a Wednesday night, I think it was, and it might have been a little bit early. And one Wednesday night, he was getting ready for, might have been a Tuesday night even, but he was getting ready for his RU class, Reformers Unanimous, to where he spends his heart and life trying to help folks that have all kinds of addictions in their life. But it's just great to see a pastor ministering and serving that has a heart to just help the hurting, love on people. We're proud of him. We love him and his ministry and his family. We're grateful that he could be here today and preach for us. He'll come right after they sing in the trio.
All I could see was the surrender. morning, first of all. It is great to be with you. Thank you for the opportunity. If you have your Bible, turn with me to Romans 5, and I want us to look there for a few minutes this morning. It's always a joy to be here. It's always a privilege to be on this campus. I'm always honored anytime to be able to open God's Word here, and I'm very grateful for the privilege to be able to do this today. And by the way, I just got my invitation. Thank you. And I feel very honored, and so I appreciate that very much. Thank you. Romans chapter 5, and I'm going to share a few thoughts at the beginning, and then we'll get right into the message. But if you'll be kind enough with me, if you'd stand in reverence to God's Word. Romans chapter 5, beginning in verse 1. Therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. And by the way, we can stop there and just say amen. Right?
Amen.
By whom also we have access by faith into this grace wherein we stand, and rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. And not only so, but we glory in tribulations also. How many of you got that part mastered? All right, I'm still working on it. Knowing that tribulation worketh patience, and patience experience, and experience hope, and hope maketh not ashamed. Because the love of God is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost, which was given unto us. The title of the message this morning is simply this: Holding On for Dear Life. Holding On for Dear Life. Let's pray, and you guys can be seated, all right? Father, it's an honor to be here. Thank you for what we have through Christ Jesus. I'm honored that you count me worthy of bringing the gospel to me. I didn't seek you. There's no one in this room who sought you. You sought us. I know it's true. I understand it fully. But to say I totally get it, I don't. Because I know me. And I know what you did in reaching out to a sinner such as Ken Cash. I am forever grateful. And to be honest, Father, have been forever changed. And Lord, I pray that the thought you've laid on my heart today, just shared with my church just a week ago, Lord, may someone today, someone, Lord, it may not be for everybody, and that's okay. But Lord, I pray that there would be one hearer here today that would take not the preacher's words, but take the word of God and put it in their heart. And Lord, live this out. Lord, we thank you for this time together. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. You know, I got saved at 17. I was not raised in a Christian home. I'm a first-generation believer. You know, I don't have, quote-unquote, the pedigree where, you know, second, third, fourth generation. It started with me. And I came to know the Lord, and I am grateful for what the Lord has done for me. And also, now second generation, my kids, raised in a Christian home that I didn't get to have the privilege of being in. And I'm just grateful that their life was different than mine. You know, and even in that journey for me, just a lot of things in life, I'm now 50, none of your business, okay? And so, you know, those years have rolled. And, you know, I just can't believe I've been a Christian 39 years. If you do the math, you can figure it out. Saved at 17 plus 39, you'll get it. Okay? And so, but in my journey of 39 years, you know, there has been an amazing journey for me. It has been a great opportunity for me to know the Lord. It's been a great opportunity for Him to mold me in that time frame more and more into the image of Christ. I realized that 56, there's a whole lot I didn't know when I was 46. When I was 46, I realized there was a ton I did not know at 36. And you just keep going back with that. By the way, I learned early on in Bible college days, the most dangerous Christian alive is the sophomore at Bible college. Because I really do think they know it all. If I was that pastor, I'd tell you what I'd do. If I was in that church, here's how I'd... It's probably why you're not there yet. Okay? And so, in my journey, there's just been some things that God has brought into my path that didn't go away right away. I had a child, my second child, Rebecca, who's a graduate of here, was born prematurely, and we went a year and a half journey where she was on an apnea monitor and trouble breathing and trouble with her heart rate, and to be honest, it was just a year and a half that didn't go away. And it was a long journey for us, and the Lord taught amazing things for us, but it was just a really hard, hard journey. My daughter Rachel, who is a graduate of this school, was in a horrific car accident 9 years ago, and was supposed to have died that day. And it was just horrible. Drive up on the accident right after it happened. I can't even get in the car because she's pinned. And she's just bleeding, both ears bleeding out. Horrible brain injury. And that was a long journey for us. Both of those God healed in miraculous ways. Today, okay, we, with our school, my wife and I, we lead a team from our high school on a mission trip every spring break. And we've been to Ecuador 3 years, the last 2 years in Bulgaria. And so I'm on a plane, just got back from Bulgaria, and my phone had it off, turned it on as soon as I get into the Raleigh-Durham airport, and it's my daycare director. He said, I need you to call me as soon as you get this. And long story short of it, and by the way, it's the culture we live in, guys. It's the culture you serve in, that I serve in. My daycare director was arrested with a false charge of abuse on a child in our daycare. That case is still pending. It's in court right now. We go back to court October 31st. It's been going on since April. In the meanwhile, the media, we had TV stations parked outside our campus and putting us on the news on how we're abusing children. It's been hard. In the meanwhile of that, we had another member of our church that had a false charge brought against them, and just talked with him yesterday, and that goes to a case on Monday. Just a lot of stuff. It's not easy. Brother Jim, I didn't have a class in college that taught me how to deal with what happens when your daycare director gets arrested. Just be honest. You guys had that class here? Okay. What do you do when the city falsely accuses you? When the media comes out of the woodwork to, what do you do? And what do you do when it goes on month after month after month? You know, there's been many a day, guys. You know, I've been in ministry over 3 decades now. And I'm just being as honest with you as I know how to tell you. There's times in this flesh you get tired. Okay? And you just think, Lord, I'm going to be faithful to the end, but I'm just going to be honest with you. There's some days selling insurance doesn't sound that bad. Amen? And so I want to share just something personal for me that God has used to help me to put into kind of a sermon. But I hope it'll help someone here. Again, the title of the message is Holding On for Dear Life. We read in our passage, and Paul is talking about, you know, there's going to be times in our life that tribulations are going to come. Those hardships, those difficulties, and they're natural, they're going to come. And when they do, realize that God is using that circumstance, that event, those areas that are now going on in your life that are not going away right away, but he is using those to mold and shape in you. For one of those, he says, for patience. You know, if you'd allow me, the King James word for patience, it's also known as endurance. Translates as endurance. And guys, you listen to me. If you're going to go until Jesus comes back, or until you go to be with him, you have to learn what endurance is. Amen?
Amen.
And God, in his sovereignty and how well he knows us, he allows seasons of things to come into your life to begin to produce in you the ability to learn how to endure until you hear "well done" one day. And out of that, he'll bring in. I mean, I remember seasons in college where, you know, the workload and having to work a full-time job, full-time in school, and, you know, it just seemed like at times it was relentless. Amen, guys? And he just thought, man, and that was an entry point to learning the great virtue of Scripture, and that is how to endure. Okay? Because if you're going to go the distance for the Lord Jesus Christ, this is a life lesson. This is a virtue God has to mold and carve out in you, because there's nobody in this room who wants to go the distance if the way I get there is through tribulation. Nobody wants that. We want to go the distance because we led somebody to Jesus every day until we die. Right? But that's not always how it's going to be. And so you're going to have to learn with what God is allowing into your journey the great virtue of endurance. By the way, God knows me just as he knows you perfectly. And if he keeps you away from tribulation, probably it's because he doesn't trust your walk right now. Because he's never going to give us more than we can handle. Amen? And so, in your journey, if you really are in your sanctification, becoming more and more like Christ Jesus, then there are going to become, as you go through your journey, at times deeper and deeper and deeper, tribulations, because God's going to use that classroom to mold your life and so that you can endure and fight the good fight, and finish well. Now, people don't sign on for that. I tell our staff, ministry, and this is ministry, guys, is climbing to the tallest branch of a tree that will hold you, and you personally climb out on the furthest point of that branch that will sustain you, and those whom you serve, you give them a saw. And at any time they just don't like you, they can cut that branch off. And if you're not willing to be that vulnerable, and if you're not willing to be that frail, you hear me? God can't use you. You've got to be willing to risk whatever it takes to serve. You see, we give this idea sometimes ministry is all glamorous. No, it's not. Sometimes ministry is extremely painful to the point where it can devastate you if you're not where God wants you to be. Amen. And so, this message is just kind of an overflow of what God's been teaching me since April with what's been going on in our ministry. By the way, let me tell you this. Sunday will be the fourth straight week we've had baptisms. Amen?
Amen.
And we're seeing folks saved on a regular basis, and people are being touched, and we're seeing God still do what God does because you stay faithful in the midst of your tribulation. And God honors it. Because again, the end of the day, the work is of God, not of us. We just align ourselves up with what he desires, and when we do, he blesses that. Don't you dare think for a moment you've done it. Okay? Please don't be that arrogant. If anything happens that's praiseworthy, the truth is it's kingdom change. God did it many times in spite of us, not because of us. Amen, guys?
Amen.
And so what do we do when we're going through that season of tribulations? That's what I want us to look at. I heard this illustration. There's a cargo flight from Portland, Maine to Boston, Massachusetts. And this is in 1987. The pilot of the plane had heard a noise from the back of the plane, and so he turned the controls over to the co-pilot, and he said he would go check the noise. And he got back to the back of the plane, and the plane had hit an air pocket, and the pilot was tossed against the back door of the cargo plane. He quickly realized the source of the noise coming from the back of the plane. It was the rear door that hadn't been shut properly. And as he was tossed against the door flew wide open and the plane instantly sucked him out. And the co-pilot, seeing the red light that indicated there was a door open, immediately asked for an emergency landing. And he reported that the pilot had fallen out of the plane and requested immediately there be a helicopter to be dispatched to search around the ocean where he was flying over. And after the plane had landed, the ground crew found the pilot, the one that was sucked out of the plane. He was holding on to the outdoor ladder of the airplane. And somehow, when the plane sucked him out, he managed to hold on for 10 minutes. It took 10 minutes for that co-pilot to get the plane down. And for 10 minutes, that pilot held onto the ladder, traveling over 200 miles an hour, 4,000 feet in the air. And as the plane landed, the pilot that was holding on had to lift his head as the plane landed. And his head was no more than 12 inches from the pavement as the plane landed. That's a bad day. According to the news report, it took several people to pry the pilot's fingers off the ladder. Can I tell you, that's a picture of endurance, amen? The ability to hang on when it's easier to let go. That's endurance. Endurance is the power of going on in spite of difficulties. It's people using phrases to describe endurance, such as just keep on keeping on. Hang in there. The synonyms of endurance are determination and perseverance and stamina. And in our text this morning, we read another word from the King James, and it says patience. The word endurance is used in the Word of God in several different places. And the general meaning, if you did a word study of all of the usages, you would find three main meanings of the word endurance in the Bible. One means to abide under. Another means to bear up courageously. And the third one means to just simply tarry or wait. And we understand that in the scripture. If I'm going to endure, I'm going to abide under the strength of my God. If I'm going to endure, I'm going to bear up courageously as God would tell Joshua and Moses, right? Be thou courageous. It's the same meaning. It is endure to the end. It also means to endure. Sometimes I just have to sit and wait on God. What I'm doing right now, I am sitting and waiting on what God's going to do with what's going on in our daycare. And just wait. Walk with integrity. Do what God's asking us to do. And wait on Him. The Word of God considers the attribute of endurance as a priority for the Christian life. And Paul expressed it in our text this morning to be something that God's really trying to carve out in us if we'll let Him. writer of Hebrews also took note of it. In Hebrews 10:36, he says this, "For ye have need of patience," again, the word endurance, "that after ye have done the will of God, ye might receive the promise." We do the will of God through endurance, through patience. Child of God, if we're going to make it to the end and hear "well done," then we must possess endurance for the journey. And so how do I stay focused? It's my question. It's for me. How do I stay focused in a life of constant change, the roller coaster of emotion on any given day based on what comes our way? And our passage gives us some practical things I want us to look at for just a couple of minutes this morning. First of all, according to our text, I want you to notice that if I'm going to endure, and I want you to hear this, but before, and I understand, listen, I'm as conservative as you're going to find, all right? But I don't want you to tune me out with what I'm getting ready to say right out of the gate, okay? You guys with me? You're not going to tune me out, are you? I don't want you to listen, and then I'll come back and explain, all right? No one throw their Bible down and storm out, all right? Don't throw the chairs. Don't do any of that stuff. Just hear it, okay? If I'm going to endure, number one, I must accept change. Now, I didn't say compromise. That's a whole different topic. In our text, and if you read our text, Paul says this, "We glory in tribulation." Can I remind you that in our text, tribulations are going to come. We must realize that God is allowing these trials, these tribulations, these difficulties for the purpose of our endurance, so that I or you can remain strong to the end. These trials come, and you listen to me, and you and I can't do a thing about it. I'm not saying accept change if it's a compromise of the Word of God, any of that, so please understand that. But when God allows a trial or a tribulation into your life, you don't have any say-so. He didn't call you and get your input before he allowed it to come. William Barclay described endurance as this, "the courageous acceptance of everything life can do to us and the transmitting of even the worst event into another step of the upward way." That's a good description. You know, let's be honest. There's some events and circumstances that are inevitable, are they not? And sometimes life's just not fair, is it? Injustices creep into our lives, and sometimes we find ourselves falling out of an airplane open with an open door, and we're just doing the best we can to hold. Can I tell you, it always helps to remember that God is always in charge of our life. Amen, church? Amen. His desire for you, for myself, is to grow into the image of Christ. So whatever comes into my life that is an unfavorable circumstance, to tragic events, to be honest, irritating people, it's always for the development of my character to become more like Christ, if I will accept it. See, most of us stiff-arm tribulations, don't we? And we don't get what God's trying to show us. And by the way, we're doomed to repeat. Can I remind you, it is an absolute perfect illustration. Whether we like it or not, life's irritants forms godly character in our life. You guys have heard this illustration. Let me say it just quick. It's the illustration of the oyster and the pearl. The pearl, listen to this. I always want you to remember this. The pearl is always a product of pain. Okay? You understand that, don't you? The pearl is always a product. An alien substance slips into the oyster and begins to irritate it, which turns, the oyster turns and produces a healing fluid that coats the irritant. And eventually the irritant is covered and his wound is protected by the pearl. Can I remind you, there's no other gem that's produced in that fashion. And this precious jewel is conceived through irritation. It is born of adversity. Had there been no wounding, there would be no pearl. Can I remind you guys in your lives, if there is no wounding, there will be no pearls. And God will use the irritants in your life to mold you into something beautiful. Can I tell you, allow God to do in our irritants what he desires to do, so that the pearls of our lives can be formed and we can trust in our God. And by the way, as that's happening, it produces endurance. Number two, not only to accept change, but number two, be willing to adjust. Be willing to adjust. In verse 3, he says, it worketh patience. It's a process going on in me. For endurance to occur, we must be willing to allow the tribulations of life to do its work in my life. There was a young Navy captain that was commanding his first battleship. And a light was spotted in the dark distance, and it was coming straight towards the ship. And the commander radioed to the other vessel where the light was coming from, and he said, alter your course 10 degrees. And the reply came back, no, you alter your course by 10 degrees. And the irritated captain of the battleship replied, alter your course, I am a destroyer. And the reply came back quickly, alter your course, I am a lighthouse. If that battleship keeps going, it's going to run aground. Guys, when irritants come our way, we always want them to move. Well, the truth is, they moving may be to my detriment if I stay my course. Those irritants are brought into me so that God will allow me to adjust. Maybe chip a little of the pride off. Maybe chip away a little bit at the arrogance. Maybe humble me just a little bit so that I'm able to be the servant, the bond slave that Jesus has called us to be. And we must adjust our lives and be willing to adjust when those irritants come. Proverbs 22:3 says, a prudent man foreseeth the evil and hideth himself, but the simple pass on and are punished. Sometimes life circumstances are unavoidable, guys. Disappointments are certain because, can I remind you, we're dealing with in a fallen world. Obstacles are a certainty, but the person who endures acknowledges the obstacles and will make adjustments as we go. And that's the process God's taking us through. Can I tell you this? I think this is true. Don't think of the obstacles as setbacks, but rather look at the obstacles as an education to formulate you more and more into what God wants. And then number three, in this text, stay close to God through endurance. Verse five, says, the love of God is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost, which is given unto us. That love produces endurance in our lives as we stay close to God. Listen to the definition of love found in 1 Corinthians, one of them in 1 Corinthians 13. And you guys know, and I get there, you'll know exactly what I'm getting ready to say. Love beareth all things, believeth all things, hopeth all things, and what? Endureth all things. You see, endurance is a component of love. Marriages that go to the distance at times have to endure. Amen? Any relationship that goes the distance at times have to endure. James Dobson made a statement, I love it, because it's true. He said, if two people always agree, one of them is not necessary. Okay? And there's some great truth in that. But sometimes in those differences of opinion, it gets on your nerves. And you have to endure if that love is going to bond and stay true forever. And so endurance is part of a component of love. Unfortunately, most of us are not very patient people, are we? It's funny, when we pray for patience, we usually will pray something to the effect of, Lord, give me patience and give it to me now. Some of you guys will get that in a minute. Or we'll say it like Margaret Thatcher said it. She said it this way. I'm an extraordinarily patient person, provided I get my own way in the end. The Greek term for endurance is long-suffering. I love that thought. It's a compound word that means long or far, and then the other part of the word is anger or wrath. And when you put it together, it means long angry. It's kind of weird, isn't it? But we have another word for the opposite of that, of being long-suffering, and we know what that is. It means to be short-tempered. And we understand that word, don't we? Quick fuse. To be long-suffering, to be long-angry. It means I don't get angry quick. It's way on down the road. Endurance is the ability for you and I to not lose our cool when the events of life do not go our way. Is that true of you? When things don't go your way, are you long-suffering? That's what God's trying to teach us. Because guys, I'm going to tell you, in life, it's not always going to go your way. It's not always going to be what you thought it was going to be. And what are you going to do with it when it comes? Because it's coming. And how are you going to handle it graciously before God when it doesn't happen your way? When I do my marriage counseling with couples, I remind them, submission. It's an interesting idea, because in most relationships, you get two people together, they probably agree 80% of the time or more. And they say, you know what, I do pretty good submitting, because we, you know, most of the time we're in agreement, and most of the time we do well. Can I remind you, that's not submission. You've got to take whatever that is. If that's 20% of the time you disagree with whomever, you have to take that 20% out, put it over here, and now make it a whole. Because you cannot submit an agreement. It's an impossibility to submit an agreement. You have submitted nothing. You agree. You're going to do it because you and yourself believe it's right to do. You only have the potential to submit when you disagree. And don't you know there's times in God, through the Holy Spirit and the Word of God, He's speaking to you and you don't like it. It's okay to amen that, all right? And by the way, if you don't agree with that, you're lying right now. Because there's times this old flesh doesn't like what the Word of God says every time. Because it calls us out, doesn't it? And nobody likes to be called out. What do I do when the Word of God, the Spirit of God, calls me out? Am I long-suffering? And if not, I'm not learning endurance. So God's going to need to bring tribulations into my life to teach me how to endure. We see this same word in the fruit of the Spirit in Galatians 5. He says, but the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, what? Long-suffering. Endurance. The secret of endurance is staying close to God so that He will always see the love of God in us. And that means daily we must be filled with the Spirit. Always remember, God's with us, and we can always draw near to Him. That's good to me. And recognize that He is with you and you with Him. Amen. Isaiah recognized this thought, and by the way, it gave him a second wind of life. And you read it in Isaiah 40, he says this, "Hast thou not known, hast thou not heard, that the everlasting God, the Lord, the creator of the ends of the earth, fainteth not, neither is weary. There is no searching of his understanding. He giveth power to the faint, and to them that have no might, he increaseth strength. Even the youth shall faint and be weary, and the young men shall utterly fail. But they that wait upon the Lord," you remember our opening definitions? That's one of the definitions of endurance, waiting on the Lord. "But they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint." By the way, what a beautiful picture of endurance for the child of God. Amen. The secret to endurance is not learning how to avoid tribulations, because we can't. The secret to endurance is desiring God's presence in your life in the midst of your tribulation. Exodus 33:14 says this, "And he said, My presence shall go with thee, and I will give thee rest." If you have not learned in your journey yet to treasure God's presence more than his blessing, you're missing out. Rather, him be with me than just his goodness. I want his presence. Because with his presence comes the ability to endure. Close with this. Years ago, Poland's prime minister was a concert pianist. He'd been going around the country and giving a series of concerts, and there was a mother who was wishing to encourage her son, small child, to continue playing the piano. So she bought tickets for one of the concerts so her little boy could go see the prime minister play beautifully the piano. And so when the night arrived and they found their seats, they were both sitting right down in front of the stage, and while they were waiting for the concert, the mother saw an old friend of hers and that was just a couple of seats away, and so she turned to speak to her friend for just a few minutes. And by the way, that was all the opportunity her son needed to explore the concert hall. And so he wandered off, and the little boy eventually walked through a door marked "No Admittance." And when the house lights began to dim for the concert, the mother returned to her seat, and she realized her son's not here. And suddenly the curtains were pulled, the spotlights focused on the piano, and in horror, the mother saw the little boy sitting at the keyboard. And he began to innocently pick out "Twinkle, Twinkle, Little Star." And the mother just gasped in fear. And before she could get to her son, the prime minister, the great piano master, had appeared on the stage and quickly moved and sat next to the little boy at the piano. And as he sits down, he whispers in the little boy's ears, he says, "Don't quit, keep playing." And leaning over the concert pianist, he reached down with his left hand around the boy and began to fill in over here. And then he reached around with his right arm around the boy and he began to fill in on this side. And as both arms were circling around the boy together, the old master and the young beginner, the crowd was mesmerized by "Twinkle, Twinkle, Little Star." Let me tell you what I'm learning in my journey. In my desire for endurance, for my journey, I live a life that's very unpolished. It's very incomplete at times. And because I have the presence of God with me, and I just deeply desire God be with me, let me be with you. I long for your presence more than anything else. Let me tell you what the Master will do. He'll surround us. And he's going to whisper in our ear. And here's what he's going to say. Ken, don't quit. Keep playing. Don't quit. Keep playing. And as I do, I'm going to watch him put his arms around me and fills in the rest of the music so that something beautiful comes out of it. Can I tell you guys, what you and I accomplish on our own is not worth mentioning. Because it's not. But in the presence of the Master, if we draw near to him, and we keep faithfully doing what his word would tell us to do, with the hand of the Master around us and the character of endurance, can I tell you, your life will be beautiful. Our responsibility is not to quit. That's our responsibility. It is not to quit. We keep playing. Keep doing it for God's honor, his glory, his presence. But it's God's part to fashion it into a masterpiece. Amen? I heard it said, God doesn't call the equipped, he equips the called. And I don't know where you guys are at today. You know, I don't know. Look, I remember my freshman year of Bible college, I was packed up at Christmas, ready to go home, right after Christmas, ready to go home. I was so discouraged. I was having to pay my bill myself. I was behind. My grades were not the best. As I shared earlier, I'd gotten saved as a junior in high school. I haven't been saved very long. And I'm sitting in Bible classes, and they're talking about these stories, and they're bored because they've heard them 1,000 times. And I'm like, who's Goliath? Why would you call your son Goliath? That's a weird name. Okay, that's me sitting there, right where you're at. And I got so overwhelmed one day, I just thought, you know, I'm done. And I had my mentor, a guy by the name of Jonathan Thigpen, just love me and encourage me. And I'm so glad God put his arms around me. Whispered in my ear, Ken, just keep playing. And let me make the masterpiece of it. Amen, guys?
Amen.
So I don't know where you're at. I don't know what's going on in you today. I don't know what you've been through. But keep playing, okay? Let God come around you. Desire his presence more than anything, guys. Not a notoriety in ministry. Don't aspire for a position in a bigger church. Just desire more than anything. God, I just want to be close to you. And keep playing. And watch God do the amazing with you. Amen?
Amen.
For his glory, not ours. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for what you're teaching me at 56. Lord, I'm excited because if you tarry and I get to be 66, I know there's going to be life lessons you're teaching me there too. And I'm just grateful that I'm very much in my journey. And I don't have it figured out yet. And that's very cool to me, God, because that just reminds me that you're still not done with me either. There's things you're teaching me at this stage of my life that I'm so grateful I'm learning. Lord, I don't know where the student body is today. I don't know. Somebody may have walked in here today and you say, you know what, I'm just so discouraged. God, may they come to you today and just say, God, I'm just going to keep playing. I want to quit. Tired. Discouraged. I don't know what in the world's going on. But I'm going to keep playing, God, because that's what you're asking me to do. And I'm going to trust that as I draw nigh unto you, that you will envelop me in your presence. In some way, somehow, you'll make a masterpiece out of this messed up life. Guys, if that's your heart, could you just come and say, God, the only thing I know to do, I just want to come and just say, God, I want to be near to you. I want to know you. I don't want to know about you. I'm tired of knowing about you. I want to know you. I want to be close to you. I want to know what it means to follow the glory of God as the children of Israel would follow the Shekinah glory. Close enough to you that when you're moving, I know to move. Father, I know you're working in my life to teach me endurance. Because that's a virtue that if we're really going to be the servants you want us to be, we must endure. So thank you for your great love and your great work. Bless these students. Even in their young lives, may they not grow weary in well-doing. May they keep playing. Thank you for the masterpiece you're making in each of them. We ask it in Jesus' name.
Once you get drunk, he can't even be accountable for what happened. So, young preachers, understand right now in culture, people know drinking is wrong. Down deep in their heart, even though they'll defend it at every other corner, right now you're seeing society get honest about what they know is wrong. Now we know why. It's Roe v. Wade is the problem with them. But they're taking everything they can to attack. And so their beer is bad. Sudden, but they hate the fact that they've said that. Going to a bar is bad, but we hate the fact that we've said that. Losing your temper is bad. He threw a piece of ice. He's not set aside a temperament for to be a justice. It's bad. But down deep in our hearts, God writes his word on our heart. So what a beautiful thing for us to see and make note of. A couple of things by way of announcement. If you're going to the State Fair on October 12th, please sign up outside of my scanner's office. Many have done that. Then I want to mention to you the mission retreat. Many of you are still waiting to do that. I hope you're still waiting. We have a dozen signed up. We really want you to go. I'm telling you, it is a great experience for you. Please take time to go. We're planning it. We're going to have a wonderful time. It's going to be life-changing, truly. It just is beneficial to you. You're able to take that $100 cost, set it aside on your bill. We're going to the Anchorage camp and conference center, and the water is there. It's going to be a beautiful time. So please sign up. We'd love for you to go, and just be a great experience. Thank you, Brother Ken, Brother Bruce, for coming. If you all would just make your way by the door, and folks will be able to shake your hand. Let's pray, and we'll be dismissed. Lord, we love you. Thank you for the day. Thank you for the message. Help us, Lord, that are going through some adversity right now. I thank, Lord, by those that came to the altar, Lord. It's an expression of things that are going on in our lives, battles that we're having, and Lord, many of us acknowledge those things to you sitting in our seats. I pray that you'd be with each one and help us, Lord, in our journey. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. God bless you. Love you. Have a great day.